Hello, and welcome to KDAM News, the monthly update for professionals working with Qt, C++, and 3D technologies. I'm Oral Brock, and before we start, just a quick hint. If you are interested in building applications with Rust, have a look at the upcoming Oxidize conference in Berlin from the 28th to the 30th of May. There's more in the announcement section below. Now, back to the news. In this edition, we have Server for Qt, an interview with Andrew Hazen and Magnus Koss. Qt 6.7 released, Hotspot 1.5 released, Embedded World 2024 Impressions, Tip of the Month, and Announcements. In previous editions, we've been talking about safe Rust bindings for Qt, called CXXQt, developed by KDAB. Lately, based on these bindings, our developer team has come up with a servo integration for Qt. My colleagues Andrew Hazen and Magnus Koss will tell us what it's all about and why they worked on this integration. Hi Andrew, hi Magnus.
Hey.
Hello.
Let's start at the beginning. What is servo?
Yeah, servo is a browser engine created by Mozilla. It was created in 2012, and in fact, it was one of the reasons to create a Rust programming language. And that is, of course, a huge part why Server is an interesting choice, because Rust is a memory-safe language. And Server development was dormant for a period of time, but now it has picked up again. So it has become a viable choice now as an alternative to Chromium.
Somewhat of a comeback, nice. What was your motivation for creating a servo integration for Qt?
As we work towards stabilizing CXXQt, our Rust bindings for Qt, we wanted to explore complex use cases and see what features are missing or whether there's API that could be improved to make CXXQt easier to use. So servo is quite a complex use case, being a web engine. One has various integration points between Qt and Rust, such as we need to pass input events from Qt through to servo. Now we need to expose the state of the engine back from servo through to Qt. And we also need to somehow render in Rust and expose that in Qt. Using servo can then also be a showcase of what is possible with our CXXQt bindings, so bridge from Rust to Qt.
Yeah, great use case, yeah. What are the biggest challenges?
So one of the challenges was that Servo is a very fast moving target at the moment. So we needed to take a snapshot of the code and also patch dependencies to get things compiling and running in the end. But by far the biggest challenge was integrating the Servo OpenGL context with the OpenGL context of Qt. You see Server uses Surfman, which is a Rust library for surface management. And of course, we have to somehow combine the OpenGL context from Server with the one in Qt. And this sort of thing is really hard to debug because you don't get the usual compiler errors. Instead, you just see a write screen if things are not working. And we also had some issues when we tried to set up the build for the Raspberry Pi, because on the Raspberry Pi, you don't use normal desktop OpenGL, but rather OpenGL ES. And we had some issues where Qt was picking the OpenGL ES version correctly, but Servo was picking OpenGL version 3.2. So the normal desktop OpenGL version, and of course this didn't work correctly together. So in the end, we had to also patch Servo to pick OpenGL ES instead.
What a challenge. How could this be useful in real-world applications?
Due to the memory safety parts of Servo and the obvious attack surface in web browsers, this is becoming increasingly important in a world where we need to secure applications. And also due to the smaller code base, this allows for easier development using Servo. So this then presents quite a good alternative to Chromium or WebKit, which are hard to keep up to date when you're using a Qt application. you could imagine situations where you will need an integrated web browser or web view in your embedded system, such as like digital signage or user manuals in cars or whatever. They will sometimes use web views. However, server is still early days and it's a little bit behind the web standards. So we're hoping in the future it will become more viable to use it in various applications.
Yeah, memory safety and small code base are two very important features for current software. So that should help push Servo forwards. Thank you for your time, Andrew and Magnus.
Thanks. See you next time.
Thanks. Bye.
If you want to learn more about the Servo WebView for Qt, read more in the blog or go to GitHub to get your hands on the code. You'll find both links in the video description below. With the release of Qt 6.7 come new features and improvements. This release focuses on the expansion of supported platforms and industry standards, making code written with Qt more sustainable. Notable highlights include support preparations for C++ 20, improvements in the Qt Graphs module for 3D graphics, technology preview support for 2D graphs creation, and the addition of a Windows 11 style for Qt 6.7 on Windows. Furthermore, the release introduces QWayland screen struct for accessing the underlying Wayland object of a Q screen for Qt 6.7 on Wayland. In addition, Qt on WebAssembly now supports drag and drop and default use of OpenGL ES3 and WebGL 2, while the Qt SVG module gains support for some elements of the SVG 1.1 standard. You can read more in the release blog linked below. For those of you unfamiliar with Hotspot, it's a standalone GUI designed to provide a user-friendly interface for analyzing performance data. The latest version, 1.5, comes packed with a wealth of code cleanups, bug fixes, and new functionality. Most notably, the disassembly view has been further improved with better searching, highlighting, and faster performance. Furthermore, the authentication mechanism has been reworked to allow Perf Record to be run directly with elevated privileges via pkexec, making the error-prone old mechanism obsolete. Hotspot now fully supports Qt 6 and KF6 while keeping compatibility with their respective predecessors. The next version might become Qt 6 only. Read more in the release blog or directly on GitHub. 3 weeks ago, Embedded World happened in Nuremberg, Germany. On the last day, we had a look around and gathered a few impressions. First, we go to Mike Kruss from KitHub, who is sharing what caught people's attention at the KitHub booth in terms of software. Qt, Qt3D, Qt with Rust, and more.
Yes, I think it has been a good year. There's a traffic that is back to what it was before COVID and all that. So it's good to see a lot of people coming on the booth and asking questions and interacting. I think there was a lot of interest on Qt, of course, because that's what we're known for. But there was also quite a lot of questions about Rust. We have some Rust demos, some combining Qt, some not. So there's quite a lot of discussions around that. For some of the demos that I came from, we had a lot of questions regarding how Qt3D can be used in order to do rendering and handling of geometrical data, for example. And particularly for the demo that I was kind of here for, there was questions about how you integrate the sensor data with the 3D rendering. So that interesting. I don't know what problems are. There was a lot of interest regarding Rust and how that may help solve some of the issues with performance or safety related to embedded systems in particular. So there's a lot of questions about that also.
Then Daniel Lang from Toradex does the same, but focuses on the hardware side of things. He's discussing things like their main product, Torizon, new boards coming out, attendance, and the latest trends.
Yeah, was very good traffic. Quality was also good, so we get some very nice lead and hope keeping our sales team busy for a while. People were really interested in our Torizon offering, which is a very easy to use Linux environment for over-the-air update, remote access, and device monitoring. And so far, we were mostly promoting it for Toradex hardware, but this year we really open it as a community. So we made known the community contribution, and we added Raspberry Pi and x86 and even competitor boards you can support. And that got a lot of interest because people are not used to see other hardware on Toradex. Other very interesting one was the i.mx95, which Toradex will begin to ship now. And people wanted to know how they can get engaged with us, how they can use it. So that was another one. And then I would say the last one was our new product family called Aquila, which is very high performance. It's the highest performance Toradex system on module ever. It has over 32 TOPS, so very good for AI, very a lot of CPU power. So people wanted to know why we go there, how they can use it, and when they can get started. So the main problem we try to help them solve is that they can use the latest technology, the latest AI tools, the latest AI framework, then all the new security requirements which are coming. That's a lot for a lot of our customers. Many of our customers, they don't have hundreds of people in their development teams. So we help them to make it easy for them so they can integrate that, so they can comply with the security without having a huge security team. We help them using the new frameworks for AI, so they're already integrated, their performance optimized, so customer can really focus on their application, on their differentiator.
You can find out more about Toradex and how to get early access to the iMX95 Verdan evaluation kit in the description below. And finally, it's a good distance in the future, but we've already marked our calendars for next year. Embedded World 2025 will happen from the 11th to the 13th of March. We hope to see you there. Managing the timing and context of signals and slots in multi-threaded applications, especially those with a GUI, can be a complex task. The concept of deferred connection evaluation offers a nice and easy API, allowing for controlled and efficient signal slot connections. This approach is particularly useful when dealing with worker threads and GUI threads. In his latest blog, my colleague Shivam Kunwa sheds some light on how the recently released connection evaluator in KD Bindings, a header-only C++17 library that implements the signals and slots design pattern, lets you decide when exactly your connections should wake up and do their jobs. You can read the complete blog post linked below and check out KD Bindings, which is available under MIT license on GitHub. If you are interested in creating applications with Rust, don't miss out on the Oxidize conference coming up at the end of May in Berlin. From the 28th to the 30th, it offers one workshop day and two conference days packed with talks from the field. The workshop topics include Intro to Rust, Confidently Using Async Await, Build Cross-Platform GUIs in Rust, and an introduction to Rust for safety-critical systems. Check out oxidizeconf.com for the complete agenda and to book your ticket. KDE has announced this year's KDE Academy, the annual world summit for KDE community members, developers, translators, designers, and friends, for the 7th to the 12th of September in Würzburg, Germany. Check out more on the event site linked below. And by the way, this year the Qt Contributor Summit will happen on the 5th to the 6th of September, also in Würzburg, for anyone's convenience who wants to attend both events. A bunch of European C++ events have been announced for November this year. Meeting C++ will take place from the 14th to the 16th of November in Berlin and online. The call for proposals is open until 24th of June and tickets are already available. The week after, the ISO C++ meeting happens from the 18th to the 23rd November in Wrocław, Poland. And last but not least, the call for proposals for RustLab, the Italian Rust conference happening in Florence from the 9th to the 11th of November, is still open until 6th of May. Why not check it out? Thank you for watching, stay safe, and feel free to share any feedback or questions below the video. I'll see you next time.